Good morning, everyone. I'm Chen Cheng. Let me kickstart this presentation with a fun fact. Can you guess how much energy is consumed by desalination plants all over the world in just a single day? Well, the answer is 200 million kilowatt hour. This is in comparison with an average HDB 5-room flat which only uses 500 kilowatt hour per month, and the entire Singapore uses 41,200 million kilowatt every single year. With that being said, reverse osmosis is considered one of the most efficient methods for desalination today. This is in comparison with conventional methods such as the multi-stage flash distillation, which uses 13.5 to 25.5 kWh per meter cube as compared to 3 to 3.5 kWh per meter cube for reverse osmosis. Despite its high efficiency, high energy consumption remains a significant burden to the industry, and hence, the most pertinent question asked today is, can reverse osmosis desalination produce fresh water at a competitive rate? This is a typical diagram for the process of reverse osmosis. Pre-filtration is required in two steps. Firstly, in a pre-filter, and next, in a carbon filter, before the feed actually enters the membrane, which will be the main focus for our presentation today. Current technology requires pre-filtration to be done as it removes macromolecules from the feed before entering the membrane. What this does is that it reduces the fouling rate of the membrane. So you may ask, what exactly is fouling? Let me show you in the next few photos. On the left, this is a hollow fiber membrane which is brand new and before fouling. And so this photo on the right is fouling. The membrane actually turns brown and becomes unsuitable for usage. Much research has been done regarding membranes, more specifically on the prevention of fouling as well as the slowing down of fouling process. However, much less emphasis has been given to pressure drops due to differences in surface area. This is what we learned in the Bernoulli's equation. A change in surface area would lead to a change in pressure. And as the fluid flows from point 1 to point 2, it reduces the fluid pressure, and this effect is termed as the Venturi effect. So, what exactly is the cons of pressure drops? Firstly, it lowers the efficiency of reverse osmosis process. What this does is it reduces the effluent quality and hence lowers the revenue earned from it. The implementation of a pump is often used as a countermeasure, and it results in higher costs in the form of higher operating costs and higher capital costs. This report seeks to suggest an improvement to current technology by obtaining an optimal cross-sectional area to length ratio. Keeping volume constant, cross-sectional area and length are inversely related to each other. The experiment focuses on using modules of varying cross-sectional area to length ratio and emphasizes on two main criteria. Firstly, effluent quality. This would be measured by a digital sensor probe. Effluent quality refers to the amount of salt left in the effluent. The lower the salt concentration, the purer the effluent water, and hence, the higher revenue earned. Next, initial differential pressure would be our next criteria. Fixing the effluent quality, we would vary the pressure so as to attain the required standards. The aim of this would be to lower the pressure needed initially, and hence, this would translate into lower costs. In a nutshell, finding the optimal ratio would result in minimizing pressure drops. This report seeks to address the results, and hence, we can talk about the potential development of a scaled-up application. What this could do is potentially reduce costs in the industry, leading to high cost savings, and hence making reverse osmosis desalination a more viable and cheaper option in the future. With that, I end my presentation and I thank you for your time.